need sheets in the back that were passed out this morning. Those are the most recent ones. So be sure and keep those and pray for those folks that are on there and other needs that you might know about. So now that we got all this out of the way, we want to worship the Lord. Thursday night is the Sullivan Baptist Association meeting, and they're having it where this year, Sullivan?
Indian Springs,
okay. I knew it was one of the big churches, but anyway, it'll be at Indian Springs Baptist Church this year, if you'd like to come.
Sign up from 5 to 6, meeting starts at 6.
5 to 6, sign up, meeting starts at 6 o'clock. You know, if you're not a messenger, you're certainly welcome to go. They're extremely exciting. And you don't want to miss them. So we encourage you all to come out, all right? I know Ron, he was the moderator for some time. And anyway, I don't know who's preaching this year. Have you read anything about it, Ron? You seen anything?
Guest preacher coming in, Tennessee Missions something. I didn't recognize his name. So.
Oh, I did. It was Charles Stanley. Charles Stanley will be. We'll get that place filled up, won't we? Anyway, all right. So we'll put all the things that we have to think about aside and focus on one thing, and that, of course, is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's look to him to bless our service with his presence, and let's just pray that we feel the Spirit of God in this place today. So let's pray together. Father, thank you for your goodness and your mercy. And we pray, God, that we would be able to sense your presence in this place today. We pray, God, that we could rejoice in you today, that we could rejoice in your word today, knowing who we are as your children. And we thank you, Lord, that we have been seated at the King's table, that we've been born again by your sweet Holy Spirit. And let that Holy Spirit teach us today and help us, God, in every way. And we pray these things today in Jesus' name. Amen. Just remain standing.
Good morning. We're going to sing 10,000 Reasons. Got the words here behind me.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never. And your heart is kind. Yes, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, worship Your holy name.
Here we go.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name.
Amen. You may be standing for the scripture reading.
Good morning. Crown Him Lord of all. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, for by Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He's the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything He might have the supremacy.
He is King of kings and Lord of lords.
Therefore God exalted Him to the highest place and gave Him the name that is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth.
He is King of kings and Lord of lords.
And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
He is King of kings and Lord of lords.
Amen. Pastor.
How true that is. Go ahead and be seated if you will. We'll continue with our worship service at this time with our giving. I'll have our men come forward at this time. Isn't it a beautiful day to be in the Lord's house? Father, thank you for your mercies and your grace. And Father, today as we give, we thank you, Lord, for the health that we have. And we thank you for getting out of bed this morning and being able to have the ability to come into this place and to worship our Savior, who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we pray today, Lord, as we worship you, that our hearts would be joyful, that we can freely worship in spirit and in truth, not worry about persecution, not worry about the things that will eventually come upon the church. And Father, today we pray that you would just bless our giving and this time of giving. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
stuff, that music. That's good stuff, isn't it? He reigns forever. He reigns forever and evermore. I can't sing, but I'm gonna praise him anyway. Hallelujah. What? The charismatic coming out in me here. Look out. Somebody ought to say glory. I didn't hear you. What did you say?
Glory.
Oh, man, you can do better than that.
Glory.
There you go. Who said that? Who said that? There you go. Now, practice like you did. All right, one, two, three, what?
Glory.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're here to worship our Savior today, and I can't imagine being anywhere but here on the Lord's Day. And I've really enjoyed studying the book of Galatians. When you undertake expositional preaching on Sunday morning, quite a bit of study goes into it. And Galatians, at first appearance, when you start reading through the epistle to the churches, wasn't just one church, but many churches in Galatia, when you first start looking at it, it seems to get a bit repetitive. But then the deeper you go, you find that there is different sections in the book of Galatians for different purposes that Paul writes to these churches. But as we continue the study in the epistle to the Galatian churches, I want to remind you of how the book naturally breaks down for study. In chapters 1 and 2 are personal in nature, and they deal with Paul's authority. And Paul is very passionate, and he continues to be, moving to chapters 3 and 4. And 3 and 4 are doctrinal when you read these two chapters. They are very doctrinal, and he's trying to teach the Galatians how they have gone astray, how they're departing from the gospel, the true gospel. Because they're being taught a gospel, but it's not the same, or another gospel. And Paul is very passionate about what is taking place. And then also he moves into chapter 4 and he speaks of the doctrine of justification. Where does our justification come from? Through our works or through Christ? Of course, it comes through Christ and Christ alone. That's who justifies us. That's who makes us holy before himself. But anyway, the final two chapters are kind of practical in nature. These final two chapters deal with application of the doctrine of justification. In other words, how do we apply justification to our life? Now, in the first four chapters, you know, some people say it kind of has an antinomian taste to it. What does that mean? In other words, antinomianism is no law, basically, what it means. But you got to keep in mind what's taking place here with these churches in Galatia, as is many churches that Paul speaks to. He would come in, he would preach, salvation is through Christ and Christ alone. And these Judaizers would sneak in behind him. They would stealthily come in. Jude speaks of the type that sneaks in. And they would come in and they would teach that in order to truly be a Christian, you had to go back under the Mosaic law. In other words, you had to go back to Moses' law. Otherwise, you couldn't possibly be a Christian. Now, in the first chapter, Paul proved that his gospel and apostleship came directly from Christ. Why did he have to prove that? Because these people were coming in and they were saying, Paul's not a true apostle. You know, he's a Johnny-come-lately. He's just using this for his own gain, his own purpose, and his own power. So Paul's not like the other apostles. He's not a true apostle. So when we move into chapter 2, we see that Paul is going to put forth more proof that he truly is a called apostle of Jesus Christ just as much as the other, even though his calling came in a different way. And his calling was not to the Jews, but his calling was to the Gentiles. All I can tell you is he had a rough road ahead of him because he had to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. So, having said all of that, I want you to turn to Galatians and stand. We'll begin reading in chapter 2. I'm reading from the New Living Translation this morning. It probably will be on the board. We do have it, don't we? Okay, thank you. But anyway, I want to entitle the message this morning, Seeing Grace. Won't y'all speak that back to me? A lot of Christians don't see grace. They don't see God's goodness, God's kindness, his undeserved favor toward us when we were lost without a Savior. But yet, for whatever reason, he saved us. And that's what grace is. And this was the message that Paul was teaching to the church, or these churches in Galatia. He was telling them, don't go back under the bondage of religion. You don't need to, because it isn't religion, it isn't the law that saved you, but the grace of God that saved you. So I'm going to read the first few verses here in Galatians 2. Then 14 years later, I went back to Jerusalem again, this time with Barnabas and Titus. He came along too. I went there because God revealed to me that I should go. While I was there, I met privately with those considered to be leaders of the church and shared with them the message that I had been preaching to the Gentiles. Now, was Paul preaching another message? No, he wasn't. He was preaching the same message of grace that the apostles also were teaching. I wanted to make sure that we were in agreement for fear that all of my efforts had been wasted and I was running the race for nothing. And they supported me and did not even demand that my companion, Titus, be circumcised, though he was a Gentile. Even that question came up only because of some so-called Christians that were there, false ones, really, who were secretly brought in. They sneaked in to spy on us and take away the freedom we have in Christ Jesus. I want to tell you something. One of the devil's primary tools in not just Baptist churches, but all Bible-believing churches today, is to creep in and use the tool of additions to the grace of God and works to the grace of God in order for you to be saved. But here he says, false ones who were secretly brought in, they sneaked in to spy us and take away the freedom. And that's what these Judaizers, and this is what the legalists want to do. They want to take away the freedom that we have in Christ. I can't imagine what it would be to live the Christian life and not have the freedom of the Holy Spirit within me. And by the way, if you are truly a Christian, you don't have to worry about if you fall into sin, knowing it. He'll let you know real quick if you're truly a Christian. Not only will he let you know it, but he'll take you to the woodshed if you get out of his will. A lot of people, I don't believe that. Well, you better believe that. How many of you been to the woodshed? Raise your hand. I think every one of us has at some point. I think I'm still going to the woodshed because of my past life. Some people say, no, you've been a Christian long enough, preacher, that you're past that. No, I don't know. I planted some seeds that could last my whole life. And I ask God to forgive me every day. But yet, chastening comes when we get out of the will of God. But anyway, they sneaked in to spy on us and take away the freedom that we have in Christ Jesus. They wanted to enslave us and force us to follow their Jewish regulations. But we refused to give in to them for a single moment. We wanted to preserve the truth of the gospel message for you. Father, we pray that you just bless the reading of your word this morning. And we ask this in Jesus' name, amen. So Paul is proving his authority. He's proven his authority as an apostle of Jesus Christ. And then Paul's announcement of his gospel can be seen in chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. And then Paul, his astonishment, or as I said in the message, his shock that they would so quickly turn away from the true gospel of grace through faith and faith alone, not through works, so quickly turn away from that and turn to another gospel in chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. And then Paul, verses 11 through 24 of chapter 1, he starts to put forth his defense of his ministry and who he is. These people were coming in, they were saying all sorts of evil and wicked things about Paul. You know, a lot of folks think that Paul, remember the thorn in the flesh? A lot of people think that Paul's thorn in the flesh were these people that hounded him in his ministry, trying to deny his apostleship and denying the very truth of the gospel that he was preaching to these churches. So this is what Paul was having to face. Now, we then move to chapter 2. And in chapter 2, verses 2 through, or 1 through 10, we see that Paul is putting forth the proof of the approval of the apostles that he truly is a disciple of Christ. Now, we see in verses 1 and 2 a private consultation. In verses 1 and 2, he says that then 14 years later, I went back to Jerusalem again, this time with Barnabas and Titus, and he came along too. I went there because God revealed to me that I should go. While I was there, met privately with those who considered to be leaders of the church and shared with them the message I had been preaching to the Gentiles, and they approved of that message. Now, that's what Paul is telling them. So it takes place 14 years after Paul's initial visit with Peter and James. Now, what we're going to see as we look at this passage of Scripture, we're going to see that Christians are not perfect. Even preachers are not perfect. Even apostles are not perfect. Because the apostles listened to human reasoning, Peter especially, and was somewhat drawn away from salvation through grace and grace alone. But Paul and Barnabas had been ministering the gospel to the Gentiles. That was a whole different game than ministering to the Jews. Now, when they returned to Antioch, they found that the Jewish legalists, the Judaizers, had brought their false teachings into the church at Antioch and were creating great confusion. Let me tell you, the place that confusion can be sown the greatest is within the church. It's not the cults out here. It's not the witchcraft. It's not the occult. It's not our secular society that causes most problems in church. What causes most problems in church is very simply confusion. You know, the Bible says that sowing discord among the saints, now listen to this, is an abomination. Sowing discord is compared to the other abominations in the Bible, such as homosexuality, sodomy, fornication, all the other abominations that are mentioned in the Bible. Well, how did that get to be in there? Sowing discord among the saints. Well, this was what was happening that Paul is speaking of. These Judaizers were creeping in and they were sowing discord. In other words, they were telling these people that grace was not enough. Now, Paul has set out to encourage the churches in Galatia to see grace once again. We all start in grace, whether we realize it or not. But he wants them to see grace. See the freedom that you have in Christ through the Holy Spirit. I want you to see grace. So he's very passionate about it. Now, Paul was concerned over the future of the gospel among the Gentiles and that it not be destroyed by these false teachers, because they were telling them something completely contrary to what Paul had told them. Now, In verses 3 through 5, we see, and I've read it already, you can keep up with it in your Bibles if you like, but we see the public convocation that takes place in verses 3 through 5. Now, in the 15th chapter of Acts, you can go back there if you would like to, but in the 15th chapter of Acts, we find that several witnesses presented the case for the gospel of grace. So I want to go back to chapter 15, and I'm going to begin reading with verse 6. I'm just going to read a few verses very quickly, 6 through 12. So the apostles and elders met together to resolve this issue. At the meeting, after a long discussion, Peter stood and addressed them as follows. Brothers, you all know that God chose me from among you some time ago to preach to the Gentiles, so that they could hear the good news and believe. Now, God knows people's hearts, and he confirmed that he accepts Gentiles by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he cleansed their hearts through faith. So why are you now challenging God by burdening the Gentile believers with a yoke that neither we nor ancestors were able to bear? In other words, we couldn't live under the law. Why do you think the Gentiles can live under the law? Are y'all hearing me this morning? Do you see grace? A lot of churches don't see grace. A lot of churches want to place you back under bondage of some law. It might not be the Mosaic law, but it usually is part of it. They want to drag you back under the law as quick as you become a Christian and understand the freedoms of grace. We believe that we are all saved the same way by the undeserved grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something this morning. That's the only way any of us are saved, is through the grace of God. When we start to feel that it's about us, and when we start to feel that there's some works that we can do to accomplish salvation, we actually deny the need for the crucifixion and Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. Why do we need a Savior if we can save ourselves? But thank God he saves us. He saves us. He comes to us. He takes all the steps. He quickens us. He makes us see who we are. The Holy Spirit brings quickening to the heart of individuals. We see who we are, and all we can do is bow down and cry out for mercy from a holy God, because we see just how corrupt and how depraved we are. You know, some human beings never come to the place that they realize there's sin in their lives. In the flesh, we can always make excuses for our sin. We can always come up with, well, you know, God understands my sin. No, he doesn't. Last Sunday evening, I was teaching in the Psalms, and Psalm 38. Now, you know, David was, and I'm going to shock some of you this morning, but I don't care. The Bible is the Bible, and I'm going to give you the Bible, okay? But Psalm 38, we see David in this psalm, and I knew my Sunday night crowd could handle it. I don't know about my Sunday morning crowd. But anyway, in Psalm 38, it's a man, David, who has written this psalm. Now, you know that David was called a man after God's own heart. We know that David was an individual that was loved by God, that gave him many blessings in his life. We know that David was also a sinner. We know that David had many wives and many concubines. Well, it catches up with him in Psalm 38 when he starts to cry out for God to somehow bless him because his loins are burning. Basically, most commentators say he is eat up with venereal disease. In one psalm, it says it's a psalm of chastening. So when we sin and when we understand who we are as sinners, even when we sin, we know that chastening must come. I never will forget watching an interview on some Christian TV show one time of a man that had lived a very promiscuous life in sodomy. He had been involved in all of the bathhouses and all of the clubbing and all of the things that's so filthy among that lifestyle. And God miraculously saved him, as he will. God can save the most base sinner, no matter what we've done, no matter what you've done, is no worse than what anybody else does, because we're all depraved in the sight of God. Now, that's something human beings need to get a grasp on. That's why we need a Savior. That's why we need the Holy Spirit to reveal to us how sinful we are. And then when we're saved, then the slate is wiped clean. When we're saved by the power of God, God wipes that slate clean. I remember when I came to the realization of that when I was a new Christian, because I wasn't the sweetest guy around. Let me tell you right now. I was a totally depraved sinner, and I practiced it. But the fact of the matter is, when God saved me, a miraculous thing took place. When God saved me, I realized that my sins had been washed away. But I beat myself up over it for probably 2 or 3 years after that. I knew God had forgiven me, but I had a hard time forgiving myself. Well, listen, you don't have to do that. Because when God saves you, He wipes the slate clean. You're as white as snow. You're as pure in His eyes. And it's not because of anything you did. It's because God showed you who you were and enabled you to repent. In other words, cry out and say, God, only you can wash me clean with your precious blood. And that's what happens. That's why the blood had to be shed. But when we're cleansed of our sin, does that mean that we're not going to be chastened for some of the seeds that we planted? I remember a preacher told me one time, Ron, he said, sowing and reaping. He said, you've sown the evil your whole life, then you're saved. He said, then it's time to start planting good. And he says, eventually, hopefully, the good crop will overcome the bad crop. But you still may have to be chastened for some of the bad crop. Does that make sense to you, Dustin? Well, this guy that I was telling, I bet you thought I forgot, didn't you? This guy that I was telling you about, that had lived this terrible lifestyle, was miraculously saved, found a wonderful Christian woman in the church. They fell in love. He no longer desired the sodomite lifestyle anymore, and he married her. 6 months after they were married, he discovered he was HIV positive. Did that mean God loved him any less? No, God loved him enough to save him. But whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. Was the slate wiped clean? You bet it was. God did not hold any of his past sins against him, but he was reaping the harvest that he had sown. Do you understand what I'm saying this morning? And I'm not saying that to be hardcore or mean-spirited or negative, but friend, careful what you plant. Sometimes I think many of the problems in my life comes from my planting. And I've tried to, not for my salvation, but for my own good, I've tried to do right. But even at that, no one can live under the law. No one can withstand the law and follow the law's perfection. We can't do that. That's why we need to seek grace. That's why we need God in our lives. But anyway, Peter reminded the group here in Acts 15 of the events that surrounded Cornelius' salvation. In other words, he didn't have to be circumcised. He didn't have to be brought back under the Mosaic law. None of these Gentiles that Paul had saved had to do that. But this is what was going on here in Galatians 2. The very same thing that they were discussing back over in Acts 15. Now, Paul and Barnabas related what God had done on their missionary journey among the Gentiles. He was telling them, hey, you know, we saw many saved. They weren't circumcised. We didn't have to tell them you had to do such and such in order to have salvation. We told them that salvation is through Christ and Christ alone and through grace alone. And they were saved knowing their sins were cleansed, not by works, but by Christ and His sacrifice. Woo!
This is good stuff. I don't know if you like it or not, but this is good stuff. You better realize what God has done for you. Do you see grace this morning? I want to ask you, do you see grace? The legalist will never see grace. The legalist will never see it. The legalist always thinks that there's something in their nature or their goodness or their self-righteousness that will make God love them a little bit more than anybody else. And that was the trouble with these Pharisees. But Titus was a test case here. He was a Gentile Christian who had never submitted to circumcision. That wouldn't be hard to do. I don't believe I would submit to it either if I was Titus. But he would never submit to circumcision. According to the Judaizers, Titus wasn't saved. Grace wasn't enough. Titus wasn't saved because he had never been circumcised. Oh, friend, how many confused denominations, Baptist, Presbyterian, how many are so confused in adding works to salvation? Those that teach you that you must be baptized a certain way by water is the only way you can truly be saved. Oh. I talked to a young man one time that got miraculously saved at a church meeting, a revival meeting in a Baptist church, worked out the Eastman. I saw him about 2 weeks later, and he says, I'm having trouble. I said, what's your trouble? He says, there's a guy at work told me I'm not saved. I said, well, what kind of case is he making? Well, I haven't been baptized in the name of Jesus only and spoken other tongues. You might not like me saying that, but I'm going to tell you right straight up. It's no different than what those Judaizers are. No different whatsoever. And then you got the water ducks, the Campbellites over here. You got to be baptized by water. And they do it big time, man. Three times dunk you down before you can really be saved. I don't care how you've been baptized. It's not good enough for them. You better be baptized the way they tell you you got to be baptized. So baptism is in a lot of ways, I think the covenant people might have it right. Maybe it is the new circumcision because they want to add it as works. You know, the infant baptism is totally founded on the fact, and this is as legalistic as anything else, these covenant people who want to talk about the grace of God, the full grace of God, teach baptism. And they say they don't teach baptismal regeneration, but they teach once you get sprinkled, then you've made a covenant, and that child will be saved, definitely. I shouldn't be talking about other groups. I'm sorry, y'all. But I'm just as passionate as Paul. As you start adding anything to salvation, shame on you. And the only way they can come up with why they baptize infants, that's the new circumcision. Man, that's a stretch, isn't it? And they also say this. The church is the new Israel. God's done with the old Israel. We're the new Israel. Hallelujah. Give them some sight. Let them see grace. Let them quit talking about grace and see grace for crying out loud. Oh, boy. God help us. But anyway, hey, I want to finish preaching this. Let me hurry along here, okay? But according to the Judaizers, Titus wasn't saved. And according to a lot of the modern-day Judaizers, legalists, according to these modern-day legalists, people aren't saved if they aren't baptized or do this or do that. It's doo-doo religion. It stinks. You can figure that out for yourself. But it does. And Paul says it stinks. What is it Paul says? I count it all but dung. No, that's doo-doo religion. Lord, I lost my sanctification, Eddie. You might have to help me out of here. If you can't handle that, you can't handle a lot of stuff, friend. But for him to submit to their demands, Titus, for him to submit to their demands would mean bondage. When we submit to the legalistic philosophies, we place ourselves in a ball and chain and under bondage to something other than the grace of God. Do you see grace this morning? How many Christians have submitted to bondage and works? Whether it be the length of a woman's hair, how much makeup she wears, whether she wears a dress or not, we Baptists. I know some Baptist churches, you can't even go in to talk to the pastor on a weekday unless you've got a daggone dress on. Don't you dare come in with no slacks. Hey, man, don't you dare come in with them old pants on, dressed like a man. You kind of see what I'm talking about there? It ain't a lot of difference between the Judaizers and these fools I'm talking about. Ain't a whole lot of difference between the two. That's pretty strong, preacher. Your pa was pretty strong, wasn't he? Anytime you start mixing works with grace, you're messing with the crucifixion, the resurrection, the need of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You're saying, I'm going to go along with them because Christ is not enough. Somebody else say amen. Amen. Y'all look like a bunch of, cows in front of an open gate. Sometimes I like to take pictures. I really would. But God knows it's the truth. It would have meant obedience to a lie. Once we give ourselves over to legalism, we give ourselves over obedience to a lie. Period. To please others, usually. To please others. In other words, we turn from the truth of the gospel to please some legalist with what we do. Listen, I faced that in my ministry before. I've been in meetings with legalists before, preachers. I felt inferior to them because they could pray in King James language. Oh, our Father, thou art in heaven. Thou art thee that cometh to me. I thought, man, I don't do that. I don't know if I can pull that off or not. Let me see. Father, thou art in thee, and thus saith to thee, you know. Oh, man, I think, man, listen to that guy praying in that King James language. That must be holy. And then I felt intimidated. I didn't want anybody to ask me to pray because I'd just say something stupid like, Lord, I love you with all my heart, and thank you for your grace, Lord, and I wish I could preach. Or I wish I could pray in King James language, but I'm just having a real hard time at it. They want to intimidate you. They want to make you what they are. They want to feel self-righteous and superior over you because you're not quite up to their standards, because you don't use the Bible they use, cut your hair the way they do, because you don't dress the way they want you to, because they don't... Oh, I could go on and on and on. And y'all looking up here at me, every one of you has been in that mess at some time or the other. Every one of you have. And nobody ever bothered to tell you Galatians is in the Bible. And then Paul's personal confirmation in verses 6 through 10. I got to hurry. Paul was not looking for some sort of personal recognition. But he wanted them to recognize the grace of God. He wanted them to see grace. Why have you so quickly departed from the truth? Who has bewitched you over chapter 3? And having begun in the Spirit, and now you've turned around, and you're going back under bondage. You let these legalists come along. Let them put chains on you and drag you back under the law of Moses. What's wrong with you people? I get passionate over these things. Paul was passionate about these things too. If you read this letter the way it's supposed to be read, you can see that. And then we see over in Galatians 11 through 21, chapter 2, Peter's relapse. What happened there? Peter got with his legalistic buddies, the Judaizers, and he went wanting to go back under the law. See, even a man of God, even an apostle of Christ, can be influenced by the legalist. But in verses 11 and 13, Peter had enjoyed fellowship with the Jews and the Gentiles alike. In other words, he had a good relationship with Jews and Gentiles. But when in the presence of some more holy, legalistic preachers, or brethren it calls them, he withdraws from this close fellowship with the Gentiles and goes over and starts courting up with these Judaizers. Well, you know, it makes sense. I was raised Jewish. Maybe they should be circumcised. You know, you guys seem a lot more holier than them Gentiles over there that talks about grace all the time. I believe you're holier than they are because, well, you practice the law. Now, this is Peter. This is Peter. Now, we see, look at verse 11. Wrong page. Verse 11. But when Peter came to Antioch, I had to oppose him to his face. In other words, Paul says, I'm going to stand up for grace. I'm going to stand up for grace. I don't care if it is Peter. I don't care if it is the Rock. I don't care if it is this wonderful apostle of Jesus Christ. After all, he did sin once. He did deny Christ thrice. How'd you like that King James English? I thought. He did deny Christ three times. Y'all probably understood that. But anyway, for what he did was very wrong. Now, when he first arrived, he ate with the Gentile Christians. In other words, he got along fine with them until the Judaizers came, until the legalists came. Then all of a sudden, he's over here courting up with them, won't have nothing to do with the Gentiles anymore. God help us. See, that's in our nature. That stuff's in our nature. But when in the presence of some of the more legalistic of the brethren, he withdrew from close fellowship with the Gentiles, and his actions had profound effect on other believers, even Barnabas. And even Barnabas got caught up in their hypocrisy. But Paul rebukes him in verses 14 through 21, and I'm not going to run down that real quick. But for he rebuked him for inconsistency in his practice in verse 14. Peter was not walking in accordance with the truth of the gospel. He had departed from grace and grace alone. He stopped seeing grace, is basically what happened. Paul called him out on this point publicly. Man, that took some guts, didn't it? Peter, along with the other legalists, were asking the Gentiles to do something that they weren't practicing. Now, Paul introduces the doctrines of justification in verses 15 through 18. It is the act of God whereby he declares the believing sinner righteous in Christ. So, we are declared righteous in Christ, not through works, but through the blood of Christ. That's how we're justified. Not by the works of the law, nor the flesh, but by grace and grace alone. Now, he pointed out the fallacy of the Judaizers, who taught that for a Jew to seek justification through Christ apart from the law would in itself be a transgression against the law. And then to once again embrace the law, which was destroyed by the acceptance of Jesus Christ, supposedly. So to embrace the law again, when Christ had fulfilled completely the law, would mean they would make themselves bound again to the law. Can you imagine what Christianity would be if that bunch had won out? And it has won out in many camps. To turn back to the law denies the work of Christ and denies the cross. It's that simple. And this is what Paul is trying to get them to see. See grace once again. Now, Paul emphasizes the importance of justification by faith in verses 19 through 21. The law is not a way of life. Rather, it means death because it condemns us. And then the way of life is through Christ and Christ alone. And the law is God's way of salvation. If the law is God's way of salvation, then Christ died in vain. Have you ever reasoned that out? I'm almost finished. Just hang in there with me a couple more minutes. Now, I want you to think that. Why on earth would God formulate a plan before the foundation of the world that his one and only Son would come, walk a spotless, perfected life in order to be the guarantor of our salvation by shedding his blood at Calvary? Why even bother if we can guarantee our salvation through our works or through the Mosaic Law? See, we Baptists, man, we're born in that stuff. I mean, I've seen Baptist preachers go say, it's grace plus nothing. Then they preach everything. No, it's grace plus nothing. But certain things will happen when we see grace. It will impact us. It'll impact every aspect of our life when we see grace. Man, I was set free when I saw grace. Whatever takes place, it's for the glory of God. And it doesn't always take place the way I want it to take place. Trust me, he's messed me around a lot. But he did it his way. God always does it his way. We don't understand his plan sometimes. We don't understand why he does it the way he does it sometimes. But he does. I've got a lot of loved ones that I pray for constantly. Oh, I do so want to see them saved. I want to see God save them miraculously the way he saved me. My boy, I thought for sure God would intervene and save him the way he saved me, but he didn't. I could be angry at God. I could have fought God. But I understood God because I understand grace. Sometimes I think God may have had mercy upon him, getting him out of here in the shape that he was in, because he was a believer. But it changes every aspect of life. We trust in God. We don't trust in ourselves. We don't trust in the flesh. How we spend our time is affected by the grace of God. Where we invest our money. How we pray. Accepting God's answer. Realizing that we do not command some puppet in the sky, that God is sovereign. How we choose a church. You know how most people choose a church, don't you? Pastor, we really enjoyed visiting your church here. I like them little short sermons you preach. I just want to ask you, what kind of activities you got, sports activities for kids? Don't y'all look up here like you're mad or something. When I die, Marcus can have them build an activities building back here. And Ray, they can build them a basketball court back here, and y'all can have upward basketball. But it won't make any money, but upward poker would. I keep telling y'all that. House gets 20%, amen. I hope y'all take it easy on me. You know I'm playing with you. But anyway, you think about it just for a second. What are you looking at? Well, at least I got my name on something. I can't mess with Marcus, man. He's got his hands on the video. But anyway, I want you to think about it just for a second. What do you look for when you go to a church?
Well, I look for the preacher to get me out before noon so I can beat everybody to the restaurant. That preacher over at Springdale preaches too long. I don't understand about half what he says. What's he talking about, justification? Is that like a vacation?
I'm being silly, but I'm being serious. That's where most church people are in America today. They don't know squat, and they never will, because they don't care, because all they want to do is get in and get out and make sure there's fun activities and lots of entertainment in the church.
I appreciate you all for putting up with me. Let's stand, if you will. God bless you. You know, I was told 31 years ago when I accepted the pastor here at this church by a complete stranger.
He said, that's some of the best people in the world that goes to church over there. And I said, do you know them? No, I don't. But anybody put up with the pastor they had for 13 years, they got to be good people. Well, I have proven that. I have truly proven that, all right? Do you see grace this morning? That's all I want to ask you. Do you see grace? Salvation is through faith, through grace alone. Not through legalism, not through works, not through the flesh, so we can brag about what we did. That's basically.